The Garry Moore Show. And here's Garry Moore and Gerber Kirby.
They're pretty as can be. I've also kissed the French girls from gay old Paris. These girls are lovely, you bet your life they are. But the ladies of Calcutta are sweeter by far.
And Gary's guests, Julie London.
The ladies of Calcutta will steal your heart away. And after it is stolen, you'll say,
I've kissed the girls
of Naples, I've kissed them in Paris,
but the ladies of Calcutta do something to me.
Robert Goulet and Bob Newhart.
We've taken out the Fräulein from Hamburg to Berlin. We've even had a date with a Siamese twin. The dolls in Copenhagen, we're glad we never missed. But the ladies of Calcutta are top of our list.
Carol Burnett. And Marion Long.
Ladies of Calcutta will set your heart aflame. We know you won't be sorry you came.
Hurry the dirty Roma, or what you gave Paris. The ladies of Calcutta are all right with me.
Why do you keep doing that to me?
Sorry.
Good evening, friends. Much love to each of you from all of us. You know, a great many television viewers complain that out of every 10 television programs, they're lucky to find one or two good ones. Well, now, if you have that same complaint, I can only say that it's your own fault. Because all you got to do is just read one of the TV magazines that give you some capsule reviews or previews. For instance, let's take a look at the week coming ahead and see what outstanding programs are available if you take the trouble to look them up.
Youth wants to know. Tonight's topic of discussion, the underdeveloped areas. Guest speaker, Jane Mansfield.
Dennis the Menace. Mr. Wilson's parakeet disappears. Dennis saves the day. He finds the lost parakeet when he dissects Mr. Wilson's cat.
Gunsmoke. Homespun episode tonight. Marshal Dillon wakes up Grouchy and kicks Chester in his good leg. Mean but funny.
77 Sunset Strip. Tonight's show is especially violent. Cookie Burns gets his hair mussed up.
The Jack Parr Show. Friendly, relaxed gab fest tonight. Jack's guests include Walter Winchell, Fidel Castro, and Ed Sullivan.
So, friends, when in doubt, consult your TV magazine.
In addition to May flowers, April showers also bring messy shoe problems. Here's a suggestion about a new way to shine your shoes from Johnson's Wax.
So let me ask you something. When you listen to your favorite singer, do you pay much attention to the orchestra? Because it plays only the harmony parts, you know. It doesn't play the melody. And more often than not, I, for one, can't tell if it's a Polish wedding march or the 12th Street rag. Let's try a simple experiment. Irv, would you please play a few bars of the number coming up right now? Sounds like the mating call of a sheepskin bicycle seat. Well, I'll tell you what. You add to that music the sultry voice of our first guest, let her sing the melody and the words as only she can. And you know what you wind up with? Not only a beautiful song, but a beautiful girl to go with it. Here is Miss Julie London.
I'm traveling light because my man has gone. Took my heart away, and so from today I'm traveling light, no one to see. I'm free as the breeze. No one but me in my memory. Some lucky night he may come back again. But until
traveling light, waiting for you.
I'm traveling light.
I was listening from out there in the wings, and I want to tell you that you sounded so good I couldn't believe my eyes.
Well, thank you, Gary.
No, really, it's just great. When you sing a song, you put everything you've got into it. And what more could anybody ask? You know, I played your new album, the one called Send For Me. It is marvelous.
Gary,
we sat... Excuse me.
I've got to talk to you right now. It is very important.
All right, just half a minute. Excuse me, Julie, I'll be right back.
Gary, now, look, I'm Robert Goulet. I want to meet Robert Goulet. He is a living doll. You introduce, I meet. Dig?
I dig. All right, but first, say hello to Julie London.
Oh, hello, Julie London.
You introduce Robert Goulet. I meet. Him a doll, him Tarzan, me Jane, you cheetah, you introduce, I take it from there.
All right, don't get all upset about it. He's an easy guy to meet and a very easy and pleasant fellow to talk to, isn't he, Julie?
Oh, yes, he just couldn't have been more charming when you introduced him to me, Gary.
That's right, sure. Now, let's talk about you for a while.
You introduced him to her?
Yeah, I introduced him.
And now after you introduce him to her, you're going to introduce him to me?
That's right. What were we talking about?
I forgot.
Well, we'll have to wait till it quiets down around here. Thank you, Julie London. See you in a few minutes. Julie London. Now I come to a very happy announcement. Every year, as you well know, the movie business gives out Oscars for outstanding performances, and television gives out its Emmy Awards. And the record industry has what it calls the Grammy Awards, named after the gramophone. What I'm getting to is that a few days ago at the annual Grammy Awards, our next guest walked off with the three top prizes. Best New Artist of 1960, the Album of the Year, and the Best Comedy Performance by the Spoken Word. And I, for one, could not be more delighted. He is certainly the most amusing young man around today. Here is Bob Newhart.
Hey, I don't know if most of you at home are bothered by commercials as much as I am, but I have a little suggestion to make to you to start things off. The commercials that particularly bother me, I put new endings to, and you might try to do this. You change the ends of the commercials. This is an example of a very familiar commercial you've seen a couple hundred times of the dentist talking to the patient in the chair with this new ending. This is the way it goes. Mr. Jones, I recommend you try to brush your teeth after every meal. You have entirely too many cavities. Well, Doc, I can't carry a toothbrush around with me all day. Oh, say, that's right, isn't it? All right. This is also the time of the year when you will be reading about a ship. Yeah, that's it. Let me write that down, would you, just a minute? In case we forget it. This is about the time of the year when a ship will break in half off the Florida coast, and some captain will remain on board, and of course all the newspapers covered and all the magazines and all the TV stations. And this very heroic figure, which from time to time about this year sort of buoys us all up, and usually CBS will go down to cover it, and it's usually covered like this. This is David Schoengren aboard the Coast Guard cutter Vandalia. We're barely 200 yards off the once proud ship, the flagship of the Swedish Freighter Company. And through the driving rain and the high seas, I can just barely make out the solitary figure of the captain, an heroic human being against a vast and angry sea. Get me off this lousy boat! This is what I really came to talk to you about tonight. My lecture for tonight is on, as many of you know, if you've gone to work for large corporations, Usually during the first week, they invite you into a room. And in this room is a screen on which they are going to show slides. And there's a phonograph record and a record on it. And it's called the New Employee Talk. And all the new employees for that week are brought into this room. And on the record is a man's voice. And from time to time, it will be interrupted by a bonk, which is a sign for the slide operator to change the slide. And this is sort of a stereotype of all the new employee talks I've attended. Welcome, new employee. Bonk. And welcome to the United Insurance Company's family. We certainly hope you'll enjoy it here. First, we'd like to tell you a little bit about the history of United. Bonk. On the first page in your booklets, you'll see this picture of our office as it was in 1900, the year it was founded. And on page two, bonk, as it is today. As you can see, it is entirely unchanged. Even to the desks and some of the employees. Speaking of employees, bonk, here is a picture of our oldest employee, Dale Vendeventer. Dale Vendeventer, in the great tradition of United Insurance, started in the mailroom in 1910 and is still there. You see him here being congratulated by our president, Dale Vendeventer Jr. at a party celebrating his fourth stroke. You have also received a copy of our company newspaper, United Doings. It is an interesting and exciting newspaper and keeps you informed of what is happening throughout the company. Here on the first page, you see a picture of our second oldest employee, Alan Grape, and his four sons, four of his five sons, who now work for United. Alan's oldest son, Mark, is the only member of the family who doesn't work for United. Mark is a bookie in New York City. On page two are some very interesting pictures of our annual strike. And here's a familiar face, Dale Vendeventer Sr. overturning the car of our president. Here you see some of our employees beating up our director of labor relations. This next picture is a little blurred. They turned on the cameraman. Here you see some pictures taken at our annual suggestion dinner. Here you see Cecil Treadlow receiving a $10 gift certificate for his winning suggestion. He suggested that we do away with the suggestion program. And on page four, our company sport page, you see our bowling team captain, Byron Logan, trying to stick his fingers in the bald head of our auditor, Mr. Raoul Smith. Probably gathered by now that United is a fun place to work, and we hope you enjoy many happy years here. Thank you very much.
So marvelous to hear something so fresh and new. Now, this being a variety show, we like to offer a little bit of everything, and right now we would like to present a talking dust cloth. Never seen a talking dust cloth? Excuse me, dear. Why are you applauding? What are you applauding?
Oh, the commercial.
Oh?
Oh, it's marvelous. You know, I think it's marvelous.
Well, I take it that you like the Johnson Company.
Oh, yes. And you know, they make a wonderful automobile, too.
Miss Lauren, dear, Johnson's makes wax. Plymouth makes automobiles, and you made a mistake.
Oh? Oh, well, to each his own.
And what I make sometime is predictions. Making predictions is usually a thankless task, but I'm going to stick my neck out anyway. The fellow you're about to hear is going to be our next big star in the world of musical comedy. He's handsome, he has a magnificent voice, he is at the moment appearing on Broadway as Sir Lancelot in Camelot. Let's have a large welcome for Robert Goulet.
seem gray to me. And troubles begin to brew. Whenever the winter winds blow up a storm, I concentrate on you. When fortune cries nay, nay to me, and people declare you're through, whenever the blues become my only song, then I concentrate on you, on your smile so sweet, so tender. When at first my kiss you decline, draw the light in your eyes. Can't be wrong. I concentrate on you, on your smile so sweet, so tender. When at first my kiss you decline, on the light can be wrong. I concentrate on you.
Great voice, don't you think so, Carol?
Oh, he's beautiful. Oh, and he's old man. Oh, hey, Garry,
huh?
It's my birthday next week. Now you know what to get me. He introduced me.
Now, down the girl, little restraint.
All right, you're right. Be aloof. Don't get carried away.
Hi, Robert.
Okay.
I want to tell you that King Arthur would have been proud of you, boy.
Thank you very much, Jack. By the way, we haven't met.
Oh, yeah, so I understand. Carol, I would like you to meet Robert Goulet.
Must I?
Robert, this is Carol Burnett.
John.
Sally Ho. I must say, I saw you in your show, Camelot.
Did you like it?
Oh, you were wonderful! You were so gorgeous! He was beautiful! I never saw anything like... He played Sir Lancelot, and he was a knight in shining armor. Oh, I wish I'd had a can opener.
Oh, well.
I'm sorry. I imagine we'll meet again, like,
After the show, huh?
Carol, aloof.
Terribly middle class of me.
She's quite a girl.
Yes, she is.
Is she always like that?
Oh, no, that's nothing. You want to see her when she gets excited. We'll see you later in the show. Robert Goulet. Now, for a little change of pace, we take one jazz combo, we blend them with a swinging vocal group, one hip announcer, and it comes out like this.
And now, welcome back to the second half of the Garry Moore Show. And here's Garry.
Thank you, Derwin. One of the
most memorable experiences in the life of any married couple is the day when they arrive home from the hospital with their first baby. Of course, they're apt to be rather nervous about this new responsibility, as you will see for yourself, as we look in on a young couple spending their first night at home with their very first baby.
Mother's out in Indiana.
Oh, yes.
Maybe he's hungry.
That's right. He only had about that much of his bottle.
Is that all? Well, do you think he's all right?
I don't know. Let's weigh it.
Honey, shh. Listen. He stopped. Shh.
Yes, he's not crying anymore. I wonder why he's not crying anymore. He's been crying all night. He should still be crying. Why isn't he crying? Maybe he swallowed his blanket.
If he swallowed his blanket, he'll be cold.
Yeah.
I'll go see.
Oh, I can't look.
Shh. He's all right.
Is he all right?
He's all right.
Oh, isn't he a little sweetheart?
Oh, he sure is. Yeah. Boy, he is sure my son, too. You know that? He's got my eyes and my hair, my ears. And your big mouth.
Quiet, he stopped.
Well, good. Now maybe we can get some sleep.
Dear.
Why couldn't your mother stay here and take care of the baby?
Because my mother's over at my sister's taking care of her baby.
Well, I wish I'd have known your sister was going to have a baby.
Why?
Because we would have waited until your mother was free.
Well, it's too late to think of that now. Come on, try to get some sleep, will you?
Okay, dear.
Oh.
Oh, boy.
Good night, dear.
Good night. Turn the light off, will you?
George!
Yes.
Where's the baby? He's snoring.
That was you.
It was?
Yes.
Nervous.
Look, honey, let's cut out all this nonsense. You know, dear, we're acting like a couple of idiots.
I know.
Every time the baby cries, we get hysterical.
I know.
A baby is supposed to cry. It says so right here in the book.
Yeah.
It says it's normal for a baby to cry. It's good for a baby to cry. It's healthy for a baby to cry. The baby's crying.
I'll get him.
No, wait, I'll go.
Don't you pick him up.
Why not?
You'll drop him.
Why would I drop him? I'm his father.
Be careful.
Now go fix his bottle.
His bottle. What'd I do with the bottle? Oh, it's in the bottle warmer. Oh, that's clever. Oh. I wonder if it's warm enough. Oh, yeah.
Honey. He stopped crying.
Oh.
Yes. He just wanted to be picked up, that's all.
Oh.
You see, he's new here, dear, and that's why he feels insecure. He just wants human contact, that's all. Of course, he has to be loved and wanted and protected. That's all there is to it. Here, now, go to Mommy. There.
Thank you.
Did you miss your mommy? Did you want to see your...
You idiot.
What?
That's his teddy bear.
How did I know? It was dark in there. And besides, he's not crying anymore.
Come on, let's try to go to sleep.
Okay. I just hope I can work tomorrow. This whole thing is making a nervous wreck out of me.
You just lie down, sweetheart. That's all you have to do. Try to relax and you'll feel 100% better.
Okay. Good night.
I'll get it.
What's that?
Hello? What? Now? All right. He'll be right over.
Who was that?
Mrs. Jones. You have to make a house call. Her baby's crying.
Ago, we had a guest on the show, a lady from Massachusetts named Mrs. Laurie Siemens. I'm sure you remember her. She's the one who took such great Polaroid pictures. And we showed a few of the enlargements made from her 10-second snapshots, and we've been hearing about it ever since. It seems that more people than ever before started sending pictures to the Polaroid people to have them enlarged. And so many of them were so great we thought you would like to see them. Now, here are enlargements of just a few of the thousands of fine snapshots that have been sent in to be enlarged. All 10-second Polaroid pictures taken by amateurs like you and like me. Now, here's one taken by Mrs. J.B. Watson of Berkeley, California. Now, that's certainly the kind of family shot we'd all like to have. And this one is by E.L. Matthews of Stark, Florida. Imagine the fun they had seeing it just 10 seconds after it was taken. And Mr. Hanish of Harrisburg shot himself this polar bear. And now notice the sharp detail. You can even see the water drops. And look at this shot that Mrs. Harry O'Kelly of Houston, Texas, took of her dad. Isn't that a nice natural pose? Mr. Robert Woolley of Cleveland took this lovely portrait of his daughter, Sandra, and he did it indoors with just window light, no flash. And this one by D. Graham of Telford, Pennsylvania, kind of broke us all up. Who ever heard of a cross-eyed cat? But aren't they just great? Now, how do you get pictures like that? Well, Derwood, will you show the folks?
All right, just like this, Gary. Nice smile.
You know, it really is remarkable that all of these professional-looking enlargements were actually made from 10-second snapshots, like the one I just took of Garry. Now, friends, don't expect this picture to be a prize winner, because, after all, Garry isn't as photogenic as the cross-eyed cat. But we do get to see the picture in just 10 seconds. Oh, you nut. Look at that.
My friends, you can do it too. Get yourself a 10-second Polaroid land camera this week and start getting great pictures.
That wonderful year we hope you'll see. The past we appear like a memory. We'll show you the way it used to be. Remember.
And for many, it was a truly unforgettable one. It was the year that man broke the sound barrier. Margaret Truman made her professional singing debut. And that year in Congress, the Republicans were in the saddle for the first time in 14 years. Folks were beginning to talk about flying saucers. And in sports, the Yankees took the Dodgers in the Subway Series. It was also the year of the royal wedding in Westminster Abbey of Elizabeth and Philip. Unlike fairy tales, this was a real-life princess marrying a real Prince Charmer. In Scotland, Babe Didrikson made sports headlines as the first American gal to win the women's title in British golf. Meanwhile, Norwegian scientist Tor Heyerdahl got set for a 5,000-mile trip in this primitive raft, the Kon-Tiki. In Movie Town, Ronald Coleman capped a 25-year starring career by winning an Oscar for A Double Life. The best actress was the farmer's daughter, Loretta Young. On the diplomatic front, President Truman appointed the architect of Allied victory, George C. Marshall, as his new Secretary of State. And that year saw a record 26-inch snowfall in New York City. Say, there's an idea for one of our sponsors, Quick Frozen Plymouths. In Dallas, women kicked up a ruckus over the latest style, long skirts. Sir, how do you like the new look? And you, sir, down there. And you? Fellas complained that skirts were now so long, the only way they could tell if a gal was knock-kneed was by listening. All in all, it was that wonderful year, 1947. ...1947 will be remembered by anybody who happened to be apartment hunting as the year of the great housing shortage. Young couples were eager to find anything, just anything, that could provide a roof over their heads.
Well, well, well. You lucky people, you. Here it is. This here is the last apartment in the building, and you can take it or leave it.
Take it or leave it. We haven't even seen it yet.
Isn't he nice? We'll take it.
Well, I thought you would. It's a lovely place. Got a nice view right here through this here window.
Yeah, it's a lovely view through the wall here, too.
Harry, we'll take it. How much is it?
Well, it is rent controlled, of course. It's only $400 a month.
Oh, $400 a month. Isn't that wonderful?
Now, there's just one little catch. In order to get this apartment, you've got to buy the furniture.
What furniture?
Right there.
That's it?
Oh, isn't it nice? We'll take it. How much?
$5,000.
$5,000 for that ratty chair?
Isn't he nice? Good. We'll take it.
Fine. You folks make out the check, and I'll go out and get the lease.
Jesus. $5,000.
Oh, sweetheart, I'm so happy. Our first real home.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't want to tell you this before because I knew how much you had on your mind, but now that we have our place, I can tell you. Darling, there's going to be an addition to our family.
Oh, honey, really? Oh, gee, when?
Right now.
Right now?
My mother's moving in with us.
Out in Hollywood, one of the happier Hollywood musicals of 1947 was called It Happened in Brooklyn. It employed the services of Frank Sinatra and Catherine Grayson, and it was like Mount Everest at the box office. The star attraction of the score was a ballad, which, if you recall, went a great deal like this.
After time, I tell myself that I'm so lucky to be loving you. So lucky to be the one you run to see. When the day is through, I only know what I know. The passing years will show. You've kept my love so young, so new. And time, you'll hear me say that I'm so lucky to be loving you. You you've kept my love so young, so new and time after time you'll hear me say that I'm so lucky to be loving you.
Songs like that were part of the entertainment picture in 1947. In that year, television was growing slowly but surely, and radio was declining at the same pace. But still very big, pretty big, were the all-night disc jockeys. These poor fellas had to maintain their good humor even when being abused by some of their listeners on the phone.
Yes, man, that's right. Our clock broke. It's, Five minutes to two. Yeah. That's right. This is Happy Harry's program. You've been listening to our program and you think what? I should what? Well, you certainly have a way with words. You know, I haven't heard that expression since I was in the Navy. By the way, do you have any requests? No, I mean record request. Same to you. Well, thank you for calling, ma'am. Well, I was one of our listeners, a young lady calling from a local tavern. Let's keep those phone calls coming in, friends, huh? Now back to some of our postcard requests. Here we have one from the Andersons. They're on their honeymoon in Passaic, New Jersey, and they'd like to hear a polka. So here it is for the honeymooners, Jim and Gloria and Edna. Well, that gives you a rough idea of what's going on in Passaic, New Jersey.
For me. Remember that song, The Too Fat Polka? I don't want her, you can have her, she's too fat for me. It was a song that Arthur Godfrey had a great...
Wait a minute, hold on, boy.
What?
Did I hear you just mention the she's too fat polka?
Why, yes, I did.
Watch what you're saying, boy, because that song happens to be my wife's theme song.
Oh, say, aren't you Mayor Quagmire?
In the flesh, boy. In the flesh.
Uh-huh. Well, how is Mrs. Quagmire?
Fatter than ever.
You mean she's still pleasingly plump?
Boy, I mean she's plump and it ain't pleasing. That woman is so fat, every time she walks into a drugstore to weigh herself, the scale hides behind the soda fountain.
Well, Mayor...
Why, when she sits down on a piano stool, it has more hangover than a New Year's morning.
Well, Mayor...
She thinks she's going to heaven, but the law of gravity has another idea.
Well, Mayor...
When she stepped into an elevator, you better be going down.
Well, Mayor...
At Coney Island, she took a ride on the merry-go-round and screwed it 4 feet into the ground.
Well, Mayor, it's Mayor...
He's fat, boy.
Fat.
Oh, dear.
Now, just to put the record straight, not all the songs of 1947 were polkas about over-pulchritudinous ladies. There were all kinds of tunes about all kinds of wonderful things. Just to refresh your memory.
A small cafe, mamselle. A rendezvous, mamselle. The violins were warm and sweet. And so were you, mamselle.
The boat rides we would take, the moonlight on the lake, the way we danced and hummed our favorite song, the things we did last summer, I'll remember all winter long.
When I go to sleep, I never count sheep. I count all the charms about Linda. And lately it seems, in all of my dreams, I walk with my arms around Linda.
She's fat, huh?
She's fat, boy!
She's fat. It's a good day, I said, for singing a song. And it's a good day for moving along. Yes, it's a good day, how can anything go wrong? A good day from morning to night.
Open the door, Richard. Open the door. Let me in. Yo, Dick, you want to open the door? Somebody, you want to grab that crummy door?
The musical High Button Shoes took up residence on Broadway and started housekeeping at the Century Theater. Songwriters Julie Stein and Sammy Kahn hung out a clothesline of hits that were the envy of the neighborhood. Especially one number, an unsolicited testimonial from a happily married man to his wife.
I still get jealous when they look at you. May not show it, but I do. It's more than I can bear when they start to stare. Guess they think you're too good to be true. I still get jealous when we kiss goodnight. Unless you hold me kinda extra tight. And dear, I know a secret you didn't know I knew. I still get jealous 'cause it pleases you.
Remember the time you winked at the guy and I got the punch in the eye.
I may not show it, but I do.
Why can't you flirt with the men who are small instead of the ones who are tall?
It's more than I can say
inside.
When they start to say
my pride,
guess they think you're too good to be
a man who marries the homely kind, settles for peace of mind.
I'm jealous when we kiss.
I like them a lot. They're worth all the troubles I've got.
Unless you hold me extra tight.
Because I'm jealous as can be. I wish that you would flirt with me.
Dear, I know a secret you didn't know I knew.
You know I still get jealous. Does it please us?
Thank you.
jealous, 'cause it pleases why? Oh, you. But I still get jealous, 'cause it pleases you.
I still get jealous, 'cause it pleases you.
Spring is really with us. Maybe you have spent a happy afternoon looking at the best-looking players on the baseball field. Well, that's fine. But how about a look at the best-looking wagons in the low-price field?
And here they are, Bob Newhart. Thanks, buddy. Julie London. Robert Goulet.
We have to stay so long for a while.
Before we go, we'd like to say we hope you had a laugh or a smile.
We hope to see you soon. Thanks for dropping by. But just for now, we'll say goodbye.
So until next week, be very kind to each other, will you? And goodbye, out there.
Garry Moore Show has been brought to you by the new Polaroid Electric Eye Camera. The picture in an instant camera that automatically gives you perfect pictures in any light, outdoors and even indoors. And Johnson's Wax, makers of new pledge for waxed beauty instantly as you dust.
This is Jeremy Slate. Believe me, the action underwater can't hold a candle to the swinging action on the beach. Everybody's on the Malibu Run tomorrow night on most of these stations.
Jewelry from Brania, hairstyles by Ernest Adler. The preceding program was pre-recorded.